Hello, everyone. Thank you for attending the Microservices Tech Talk. We're going to give a couple of minutes for all the attendants to join. So thank you for waiting.
Hello guys, I think we're ready to start because nobody is attending now. So Andrei, maybe you have a couple of words.
Okay, so sure, let's get started. So thanks everyone for joining our webinar. Today we are going to first present a little bit about Provectus, which is a new company that is opening a site here in Costa Rica. And then, of course, we're going to get started with a tech talk about microservices. So here is the agenda for today. As I said, first, a little bit of Provectus as a company. And then we're going to start discussing about microservices, in particular, the service mesh. What it is and why and how to implement it. Maxim is gonna present that part. He's our solution architect here at Provectus. And after that, we're gonna have a little session of questions and answers. Then we're gonna continue with the reactive microservices in Java. It's gonna be presented by Damir. It's a software engineer here at Provectus too. And again, a little session of questions and answers. Okay. So Provectus is a company that basically started in 2010. The headquarters are in Palo Alto in the United States. Right now it has more than 500 employees and is continually growing. We have offices across the United States, Canada, Costa Rica, and Europe. And we have clients who are fast-growing startups and even large enterprises. At Provectus, we are obsessed about generating value from data through artificial intelligence and deploying it to real world. So Provectus provides end-to-end AI solutions for businesses, and we consult technology executives, machine learning, and data engineering teams on best practices for foundational components like enterprise-grade data and machine learning platforms. By the way, our offices in Costa Rica are brand new. We just launched our operation in here and we are hiring. So we're gonna show you in a bit the positions that we are recruiting for. My name is Andre and I'm a software engineer lead here in Costa Rica. Here with me tonight, we're gonna present is Maxim, our solutions architect, and Damir, our software engineer. Some of our clients are listed here. We are comfortable working with big enterprises driving multi-million transformational projects, as well as helping startups, partnering with them from early stages through all the funding rounds and successful acquisitions. So since I mentioned, here in Costa Rica, we have opening positions. Right now we are hiring Java developers from all different levels. We also have positions for DevOps engineers and DevOps leaders. We have positions for project managers and project manager leaders. And also we have a machine learning leader engineer. If you are interested, please feel free to scan the QR code or go online to provectus.com/careers. And you will find not only the careers open here in Costa Rica, but you will be able to find all the positions open internationally. Why Provectus? Because we are a hybrid work model company. That means once you are a member of Provectus, you will be able to work with our many range of customers, but you will also be able to work with our internal projects about artificial intelligence and machine learning. We offer flexible schedules. We promote an inclusive and friendly corporate environment. As benefits, we offer medical and life insurance. Also, we are AWS certified partners. So we offer the certifications as well as Udemy courses if you want to continue learning. The company also gives you gifts for birthday, childbirth, and marriages and other occasions. Also, we have extensive maternity and paternity leave, and the company offers a relocation policy. So if you would like to apply for a position offshore, then you are welcome to do it. I don't know if you have any questions so far. If you have, please raise your hand using the raise hand button in GoToMeeting. And feel free to do it at any time, okay? Otherwise, I'm gonna switch to Maxim, who is gonna start talking about the service mesh.
Yes, hello everyone. Before we start, one moment. Before we start, please answer one question. Somebody has a problem with audio or everything is good. You can put a place for positive answer plus, or negative minus, plus is good. Working fine. Two more answers, please. Okay, I think we are ready to start. So just a little bit to warm up and make some connection. I'll ask you some questions and we'll start. You can answer answer in this way as it was. So how often you can deploy your services? Any digits, any numbers are welcome also in the chat. How often do you deploy your microservices? Do you deploy them at all, or it will be good to receive some answers, some responses? One a week. That's nice. okay, and your application does it even consist of multiple dev services? Like, how many microservices do you have on your platform, in your cloud? 5, 10, or how many? For example, you can put the answer like one microservice or monolith. Why not? They're also applicable. Five dash 10 monolith as well. Oh, pretty nice. Jose, thanks for your collaboration. Okay, I think we're ready to start, and I want I want to start with this is a simple question. Why microservices? According to the Cloud Native Computing Foundations, which has the survey, 2020 survey, 92% of respondents leverage or are ready to use containers in the production. That means that the global transition from monolith architecture to microservice one is almost finished. That's only my, but I don't know. So why are people so excited around the usages of microservices? Why a lot of people are involved in that processes? First of all, if you're not familiar with the principle of microservices, there are a few key benefits of that approach. First of all, it's a faster delivery, which means that smaller size of your application, of your services, encourages frequent releases with less risk of any kind of failure or error. And that's why we call microservices with micro at the start. So next point is as isolation. It's from my perspective very important point, since if something is broken in one microservice, entire system couldn't be crashed at all. I mean, next one is flexibility, which means, for instance, single microservice can easily be replaced by a new one, which can be developed using a new programming language. For example, you can switch your Python team replaced with Java maybe team, etc., etc. Of course, we can expand this list more and more, but I just reduced it as I see in personal. So if we go back to survey, there is one interesting fact. 23% run more than 5,000 containers. And if you are growing so fast, your company growing so fast, in the nearest future, your architecture may look like Amazon's or Netflix ones. On the picture, you may see their scheme of whole system of microservices. So, of course, that architectures may bring some specific problems. For example, around security or maybe service communication, inter-services communications. Okay, let me try to explain the challenges of that architecture on the example of, for example, online team game or maybe war battle or something else similar. For me, game usage of game term is easier. The main idea here is to imagine cooperative interactions against the opponent's team. And what are the key features of these games? First of all, each player has own role and tasks. For instance, one may be a tank, another is a medic, etc. That's a simple and clear and understandable. What else? Of course, teammates must collaborate with each other to achieve win goals for the whole team. For that, each player should know about the actions all other partners of your team. So you will be able to promptly adjust the battle strategy. And let's call it communication issue. One more. During communication, each player, each member must keep team tactic in a secret or be silent if zombies are around, for example, and they can hear you, of course. And a game doesn't make sense. Game doesn't make sense if you are shouting about your next step. And we may call it security issue. So if for now, fair question, what's going on appeared in your head, don't worry. Next slides, I will explain this logic. To be the best specialist or even better with a capital S, specialist, you must spend all time on developing your own skills. For example, to be the best medic, you must heal as a magician, like a wizard. And that's maybe impossible when you also have to train, for example, Morse alphabet, Morse code for security purposes. And I described the four-person squad. And if you are stubborn, you will put all mandatory knowledge inside each soldier's head. But how to deal with 100 soldiers, or even with the whole arm, whole army. Also, you should remember that every new team member has to learn the basic skills, just for a proper team collaboration. And as a long term, it might be overpriced and overcomplicated. Now, let's say that each hero is microservice. Every unique role, we can call it a container. And this container contains the business logic of application. So these basic skills, we can imagine that they are the additional containers which must be injected into each dedicated microservice with their own business logic. In terms of programming, that means that non-business logic must be added to each application, and that sounds not really good. And of course, It may be the reason or the one of the reasons of wasting time of developers, because they have to concentrate on the configurations of every service which comes into the network, into our network. Maintaining this configuration is increasing the complexity of structure of microservices. And I already mentioned before about the communications and security issues. So a reasonable question, what's the solution of this problem and what we can do? It's easy. If we go back and try to help our squad of soldiers to be successful on the battlefield and cover all their needs, don't forget about communications and security, of course. Okay, maybe we can put something on their heads, like headphones. That's my idea. If we place it on the head and you already will be ready to fight. And if we project in this situation with headphones to the real case, to the microservices situation, it makes more sense to extract all non-business logic out of the main container and put it into the dedicated sidecar container, which will act as a proxy. So that sidecar can be implemented as a third-party application. If we try to remember, headphones, it's not of the part of our body. It's also like a third-party application. And if this sidecar will be placed on our container as a third-party application, cluster administration also can configure and maintain it very, very easy in very simple steps. So as a developer now, you are ready to focus on implementation of real business logic. That's really important to the cost optimization of your company, maybe. As I already mentioned, the sidecars handle the communication between the services. That's why it solves the communication issue. In effect, if a service wants to call another service, there is no direct call to the destination service. The request is routed to the logical proxy, local proxy, and the proxy routes it to the destination service. This means the service instance isn't aware of the outside world and is only aware of the local proxy. But how do we ensure that sidecar proxy appear on the host? To answer that, we have kind of service registration. Once a service is deployed, it automatically registered in the service registry, and IP address of that service is saved. Now, based on the list of registered services, proxy configuration is being created. Then it is applied as a sidecar to each host. This logic is shown on this picture. But we didn't answer on one main question. What is the service mesh? And actually, we only need to combine everything and determine the whole concept. There are two core components of service mesh. They are the data plane and the control plane. Why do we need them? The data plane is a set of isolated stateless sidecars, sidecars proxies, which manage the inbound and outbound traffic that occurs in all the services from our mesh, our network. From there, we can easily explain what this control plane, its aims to determine how, when, or if the traffic should be deployed or not be deployed to the service. Together, these two implementation, these two components make the service mesh at all. So formally, a service mesh is a low latency infrastructure, infrastructure layer capable of handling the high volume of network network-based communications within a microservice architecture. But for me personally, it takes too long to pronounce and difficult to remember. I prefer throwing it away, and I prefer this explanation that service mesh is a communication layer in a microservice setup. So let's define the concept, the three main goals of this concept of service mesh. The first one is connectivity. And this aspect covers, for example, service discovery, or as I mentioned, service registration, which I described before. It's maybe communication resiliency. It includes retries, timeouts, etc. For example, why I choose the retries and timeouts. For example, automatic retries are one of the most powerful and useful mechanisms a service mesh has for gracefully handling partial or transient application failures. And as about timeouts, timeouts work hand in hand with retries. Once a request is retried a certain number of times, it becomes important to limit the total amount of time a client waits before giving giving up entirely from the system. Also, not the at least important dynamic request routing, which helps in forwarding requests to a specific version, to a specific version of your service, using routing rules, which comes from already mentioned above control plane. And dynamic request routing helps with traffic shifting for common deployments, deployment scenarios such as blue green deployments, canary releases, A/B testing, etc., etc. Next important goal of service mesh is security, and typically we don't encrypt traffic between our microservices, since we know who and how performs any actions inside our network. But nowadays it's a bad practice in terms of security, particularly for public cloud infrastructure. Hence, all service meshes use mutual TLS encryption for inter-service communication. For inter-service communication between, you should, as a reminder, between the sidecars. But how this mutual TLS works in a service mesh? The control plane distributes the security certificates and authorization policies to the sidecars. In their turn, sidecars are exchanging of these certificates and requesting these policies from each one in this mesh, in this network. And after the successful this exchangement at the end, with both microservices mutually authenticated and a session key created, and communication between them can be encrypted and sent via the secure link. So the next main point of user service mesh is observability, because all these communications, inter-service communications, should be clear and transparent for you as an administrator, as a DevOps, doesn't matter. By how service mesh provides provided, by controlling network, service mesh enforces observability, providing kind of metrics which are able to automatically alert you when traffic reaches more than some threshold. So we define the concept of service mesh, but we can't finish without noting about service mesh implementations. And now I want to say a couple of words about them. Since it's service mesh, it's not a super fresh pattern, so there are already plenty of implementations with their pros and cons, but you can choose anything by your requirements. So for example, as an implementation, maybe Istio, Linkerd, Nginx, AWS, Mesh, why not, et cetera, but for now, I want to stop on a quickly look through the most popular one, which is Istio. So Istio has been announced in May 2017 by Google, IBM, and Lyft. Everyone should know this company. To set up Istio, it is required to have Kubernetes cluster launched. In the Istio architecture, Envoy plays the role of sidecar proxy. If you have a question, what is it, Envoy? Envoy is independent, separated from the Istio, independent open source project, which is widely used by different service mesh implementations, such as Istio does, of course. The core of Istio is control plane, which is called Istio D, and do typical control plane stuff like inserting Envoy proxies into the data plane. Before version 2, Istio's control plane, before version 2, Istio's control plane consisted of three units. Currently, it's like a monolith as a control plane, but sarcastic life. Three units: a pilot, which is responsible for the life cycle of Envoy instances. We call it service discovery already. Citadel, it works as a certificates manager, and Galley for the rest of configurations. And the good question is how to set up the Istio. Configurations, all configuration won't take much time. For that, there is no need to learn kind of specific language. Istio, since Istio works under Kubernetes, it is using Kubernetes YAML files. And all you need is to define custom resource definitions, or in a shorthand, CRD. With this set of these CRDs, you are able to configure different network configurations. In this list, maybe retry rules, traffic splits, which I mentioned in the explanation of service mesh. So two main CRDs in the Istio configuration to set up service-to-service communications, and we need to mention about them. They are virtual service, which answer the question how to route the traffic to a specific microservice. And another one is a destination rule, which is responsible for what's going on with traffic at the destination point. Then Istio-D converts these rules into the envoy-specific configuration and send it into the sidecar proxy. So one more thing about the Istio is Istio ingress gateway. Istio gateway runs as a pod in a Kubernetes cluster and works as a load balancer, which stays at the edge on the border of the mesh and operates the inbound and outbound traffic. So when service mesh receives the incoming request, it automatically handles by gateway and directs to one of the services. The request reaches the envoy proxy, and in turn, sidecar proxy forwards this request to the service on the same pod. Now, from the business logic perspective, the chain of these requests, for this repeating forwarding requests, it repeats again and again and again, while the result won't be achieved. The end goal of the whole request. So one more topic, what I should cover it, why I shouldn't use service mesh. Of course, this concept of service mesh is not for every architecture. And we need to remember it. For example, if your architecture have only five microservices in your cloud, maybe leveraging of service mesh is definitely overkill. So, Jose, I don't know, do we need the service mesh or not? It should be investigated. Next one is latency, and some services, service mesh users encounter increased latency for container to container in communications. As each call out to another service must go through the sidecar proxy and a load balancer, that's the reason of latency. So also service mesh increases the complexity of a container environment. The required service mesh infrastructure consists of data and control planes that operates alongside the container that run application services. And as an additional last but not least, service mesh might strain the IT budget, and it adds compute overhead to run. So right now I'm stopping to sharing my presentation. If Provectus will share this presentation, this slide with you, you can use this useful links, or you may find my contacts at the end of these slides. You can write down my email, for example, and ping me, ask any questions, and I can share these documents, these links with you. So maybe you have questions, don't be shy to ask me in the chat. I'll try to find these questions here and give you an answer. I think we can wait maybe a couple of minutes. Maybe anybody have something. Maybe if you have no questions and do not wait for a long time, the questions will be appeared in the list on my screen, and I'll put an answer in the chat maybe, or in another way. Now I want to change the presenter to the Damir. Here we go. Welcome on board, Damir, and pick up the translation or the broadcast.
Thanks, Max. Hi, all. I'm very glad to see you. Thanks for your attending. Could you hear me well? So could you see my screen? Is everything is okay? Please let me know if you have any issues before I start.
Yeah, we can see your screen.
Okay, that's good. So let's get started. My name is Damir, and I am a software backend engineer in Provectus. And I am working for Provectus for about 3 years. And almost always in my work, I am using Spring Boot, and other stuff from Spring infrastructure. And I really, really like it, because it make my life so easy. We could just build robust systems in a fast way. And what is very important, Spring always evolves from day to day. And the last major feature in Spring ecosystem was about introducing reactive approach of programming. And today, during our session, I want to investigate the servlet-based application, find issues in it, and with you, step by step, try to fix them. And of course, we will talk about reactive services, what does reactive mean, and why do we need it at all. Okay, let's get started. And let's imagine the situation. Let's imagine that we have a business which allows us to search and book flights, something like Expedia, but a bit smaller. And this is the schema of our architecture. So we have a main application, flights application, and when user sends request for searching flights, we are doing two requests. The first request goes to the legacy old application, for example, to one of the airlines. And you know, it was built in 1990s and it wasn't evolved. So it's very slow. And let's say it returns answer in about 3 seconds. And the second call is to our database where we have pre-cached flights. Let me show the code of this. Here I have a simple Spring Boot application, I hope that you are familiar with Spring Boot. And let me explain what do we have. By the way, do you see my screen well? So is it a good font size so you could see the code? Because it's important for us today. We will look to code very often. Please let me know. Okay, thank you. So as you can see here, we have a simple Spring Boot Starter web dependency and Spring Boot Starter data MongoDB dependency because we have a MongoDB as our database. And let's investigate one by one what do we have. So here is a simple controller which has only two endpoints. The first endpoint is flights endpoint, which returns our flights, and the second one is fast. It's just for testing purposes, so don't worry about it. Okay, in controller we have flight service because it's a true architecture. We have small application but with best practices. So it's flight service, and it has two flight clients. And what the server does, it just goes through these clients, requests flights from each of these client, and collects the results and returns to the user. And flight client, it's a simple interface which has two implementations. The first one is remote implementation. So here we are using REST template and just send the request to our legacy system. By the way, today I'm sending request to my local host and I have a wire mock on this port 8081 and I pre-configured it to return response after 3 seconds. So it simulates latency. Okay, good. And also we have database flights client, which has flights repository inside it. And this is simple Spring Data repository, which extends from Mongo repository. And here we also just do a simple request with random parameters. And this is our model. So it has flight ID, departure airport, arrival airport, and price. That's it. Okay, I hope it's clear. And it's already running. So let me show you. Also today, I will be using this tool. It's Visual VM. So who don't know about this tool, it shows all threads of our application. So as you can see here, I selected my demo meetup application. And here we see all the threads of our application. Okay. Let me send a request to this so we will know that it works. Okay, you see that we waited for 3 seconds and received the response. And here we could see that where our request was executed. An important note that actually for now we have a response only after 3 seconds. That means that response from our server is equal to response from the most slow, from the slowest data source. Even if we have results from database, for example, after 1 second, after 1 second, or even faster, we still will have our results only after 3 seconds, and our user will wait for this time. Okay. Since this is simple MVC application built on top of servlet stack, we have a thread per request model. What does it mean? It means that when we receive the request from user, we have a thread which is associated with this request. And the thread is responsible for bringing up response to the user. So one request, one thread. I think it's okay. I think it should be clear. And let's go further. Let's imagine the situation that, for example, we have holidays, for example, Christmas holidays, and all people want to come back home to spend this time with their family. And what does it mean for our application? It means that in this time, load to our application could be increased drastically. So we could have thousands of requests or maybe even more. And let's see what will happen in this case. I wrote a small tool at Gatling. And this tool allows to load our application. So basically what it does, it sends 150 requests every second during 5 seconds. So in total, we will have 750 requests. And I know it's not a high load, but since everything happens on my local machine, I don't want to send thousands of requests. Sorry. But it will be enough for our purposes just to show what happens. Okay, let me run this and let's see. Here we could see that our thread pool is increased to 200 threads because 200 it's a default count of Tomcat threads. And what do we see? We see that all our threads in yellow are yellow. And if we look to the legend, we see that yellow means wait. What does it mean? It means that since our calls to remote service and to database are blocking because we are using REST template and blocking database driver, our thread is waiting until we receive the response. And at this time, it does nothing. It just waits. And since we have only 200 requests, but we received much more requests than 200, we couldn't receive other requests. So our threads are stuck and we couldn't get any new requests. And this is very bad because our clients would not be able to use our system and they will just leave and go to other flight search systems. Okay. What could we do with this? Of course, the first idea is to increase count of threads and it will be okay. But we don't have infinite resources on our machines. Each thread, it's a memory and it's a CPU usage. And we couldn't infinitively grow our threads count because we will reach the limit when it will be impossible to add more threads. And yes, so we couldn't do it. And the second idea which comes, we could just add more instances and this will work. We are living in cloud, so why not? But as you know, everything costs for money. And maybe instead of adding just more instances, we could do something else, which will be better. Okay, let's see. And let's try the first approach. It's about using asynchronous servlets. Let's see how they work. So basically, asynchronous servlets were introduced from the servlets version 3.0. And in addition to Tomcat handlers pool, we have additional asynchronous thread pool. And Tomcat received the request and delegates to this asynchronous thread pool. Okay, sounds very easy. So maybe let's look. And yes, there are results of our application, and you can see that from 750 requests, only 350 requests were okay, but we lost 400 requests. And the fastest time of response was about 3 seconds, because we have 3 second latency, but the maximum response time was about 1 minute, because our threads were not able to get more requests. Okay, so let me stop this and go to this one. Actually, nothing changed here, because for enabling async servlets, we just need to return callable in our controller. And here is also the callable. So here nothing has changed. Everything is the same. Let me run this and let's look what happens. Okay, this is okay. So we still have our 10 threads. And let's make a load. Oh, sorry, not this window, this one. Okay, what we can see. So we have these Tomcat threads, and we have many, many, many MVC async threads. And they are all yellow. So we just increased our thread pool. So we have many, many threads, and they are all blocked. And as I said, it's not a good approach, actually. So this is not very helpful. And if we will have more requests than 750, we will just lose our this async thread pool. Our resources will be ended. Okay, so standard approaches doesn't work. So maybe we could try something else. Unfortunately, we have a plan B, and plan B is a reactive approach. But first, let's try to understand what does reactive means? What does reactive system mean? And this is a reactive manifesto, which was written several years ago, I guess in 2013 or 14, actually I don't remember. But it means that reactive is not a new term in software engineering world. So it was introduced many years ago. And let's try to understand what does this manifesto means. So first of all, our system should be responsive. And responsive means that our clients should receive a response in acceptable latency. And acceptable latency means that they shouldn't wait for seconds or even minutes. I don't know which system returns answer for minutes, but it shouldn't be in this way. And how could we achieve it? We could achieve it through elasticity. And elasticity means that our system should be able to adjust for the load. So if our load increased or decreased, which is also important, our resources should be increased and decreased logically. Okay. And we could do it with scalability. Horizontal or vertical, actually it doesn't matter. Okay. The third one is resilient. And resilient means if one of the components in our system fails, the rest of our system should be okay. If we return back to our web application about flights, imagine that our seat selection service is down and we couldn't select our seats, but our customers still should be able to search and to book flights. It's very important, because we couldn't allow them to not to use our system because they shouldn't just select the seat. And we could achieve this by isolation. So our system components should be isolated from each other. And the last but not the least is message driven. This means that all communication in our system should be non-blocking and asynchronous. And if we come back to our application, for now we have a blocking calls with REST template and to our database. Okay, this is a theory, it's very interesting, but what about the practice? And how could we achieve it? Fortunately, from Spring version 5 and from Spring Boot version 2, Spring team introduced a new Reactive stack. So we still have our good old servlets and we could use them. But in addition, we have new Reactive stack. And instead of Spring MVC, now we have Spring Web Flux. And by default, Spring Web Flux works on Netty, or you could use any servlet container from version 3.1. Because from this version of servlets was introduced non-blocking communication with Neo. And Spring has a reactor under the hood. And let's try to understand what is reactor. Actually, there are many reactive frameworks in JVM world. For example, Akka, Rx Java, Vertex, Reactor, which is built on top of Rx. And since we're looking for Spring today and Spring is uses Reactor, we will focus on Reactor. Okay. Let's try to understand what is Reactor. Basically, Reactor implements Reactive Stream specification. And what is Reactive Stream specification? This is the standard which allows for non-blocking asynchronous communication with back pressure. And it sounds very hard. And just to remember, it's just a set of interfaces. So you could think about Reactive Stream specification like an API. And it's very simple. It contains just from four interfaces. And you see these four interfaces on the slide. And it works on PubSub model. So we have interface publisher, which publishes data. And we have subscriber interface, which subscribes to the publisher. And when subscriber subscribes to publisher, it creates subscription. And subscription, it's something like contract between publisher and subscriber. And also subscription helps to control back pressure. We won't focus on back pressure today, but it's a mechanism which allows to handle situations when, for example, we have fast publisher, which pushes data very fast, and slow subscriber, which couldn't consume data so fast. And subscription and back pressure says, whoa, 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 not so fast. Please give me the data which I could handle. And when I will be able to handle the next batch of data, I will ask you. So something like this. And we have a processor. It extends from both publisher and subscriber, and it helps to build these reactive streams. I will show you on the example, don't worry. And in Reactor, we have two main publishers. It's Mono and Flux. Mono allows us to handle from 0 to 1 result, so maximum 1 result. While Flux allows to handle from 0 to n results, and potentially it could be infinite stream of data. Okay, it was a theory. Let me show you how it looks in code, because I think it will be much easier to see how it works. Okay, let me stop this. Let me switch my branch. Okay, here is the simple reactive stream. And let's go one by one and try to understand. Here I create flux from Java stream, from stream of integers from 1 to 100, filter them. So I keep only even numbers, then map, take the first 10 and subscribe to this flux. Basically, it looks like usual Java stream. So we also have filter, map, take for the Java streams, but here is the additional subscribe method. And let's run this class. Look what happens. And everything is okay. So we see the numbers which we expect to see, and everything works. Very important moment that I want to show you here is that in reactive streams, nothing happens until subscriber comes, and it's very important. So for example, if I remove this line and I remain only this flux and run it, we see the empty results. And this happens because this publisher doesn't receive any subscriber. And this stream of data was not even triggered. And nothing happened. And it's a very important concept in reactive streams. So just remember, nothing happens until subscription. Okay. Let's take a look. So let's come back to our web application and see how we could use it. So according to Spring documentation, it should be pretty easy because with Spring, everything is easy. So according to documentation, we just need to change web to web flux. And from our controller, we should return mono. So I returned mono. Here I have mono from callable, from our service. In service, nothing changed. Everything is everything remained the same. Okay, but I think it could be a question. If we return the mono, and we know that mono is publisher, and I just said that nothing happens until subscription comes. So who is the subscriber to this mono? And let me introduce Netty. Netty is a server framework, and it's fully non-blocking. So it works on Neo, so on mechanism of channels, selector, buffers. So it reads the data in non-blocking way. And when it reads data, it delegates it to asynchronous thread pool of Netty. So here we don't have a thread per request model, which we have seen before. Here we have event loop model, where we have just one single thread, which reads this data from buffers and writes this data to buffers in non-blocking way. So we don't block our threads. And this is good, but how is connected to Spring? And basically, it's a Reactor IPC library, which integrates Netty with Reactor through channel operators. And these channel operators are subscribing to our controllers. So subscription happens here in channel operators. And we could return the mono from our controller, and Spring's magic happens, and everything works. Okay, sounds good. So let's try it. Let me run this. And yeah, from log, we could see that for now it's not a Tomcat, but Netty started on port 8080. And let's return to our threads and look what happens. So for now, we see only one reactor thread. Okay, let's try to give some load to this. Okay, I am running my load. And we see that we have only 12 reactor threads, native threads. It's asynchronous thread pool. And let me use this fast endpoint. Opa, what do we see? Our request is stuck. So we don't receive any response, but why? Everything looks good, but actually we don't could receive the response from here. And the main problem that when we are subscribing to our Mona, we are doing it on this Netis thread pool. And in case of Tomcat, we had 200 threads, but now we have only 12 threads. And since we still have blocking requests from REST template and from database, we are blocking this our small thread pool and we are losing it. So if we see to if we look to the results, it become even worse. So for now we handled only 238 requests and we lost almost 70% of requests. So it's very bad. Okay, looks not so easy. Let's think what could we do. Fortunately, Reactor has a mechanism of schedulers to handle this. And schedulers, it's something like thread pools. So you could see, you could think for scheduler as an executor service. So Reactor has a bunch of default schedulers, and it's something like predefined thread pools. And we have two main methods, subscribe on and publish on. And these methods allows us to control our threads on which we are running our operations. Okay, as usual, let me show you this in code. And I think it will be easier to understand because nothing is matter until the code is shown. Okay. So let's first understand how subscribe on works. So we still have our flux. It's the same flux from the previous example, but now I have added some locks. So I am printing the thread on which we are performing this action. And let me to comment this first and run. And what we can see, all our operations were executed on main thread. This happened because we subscribed to our flux on the main thread. And all operations from up to down were executed on this main thread. And actually this happened when we run our web application. So we subscribed on our native thread pool and all our operations were executed on native thread pool. But it's very small and that's why we lost everything. Okay. Now let me add this subscribe on method and look what happens. Yeah, sorry, I forgot to say that here we pass the schedulers and it's bounded elastic. And bounded elastic thread pool scheduler, it's something that Reactor team suggests to use when you have heavy operations. So it's a default. And what we are seeing now, we are seeing that all our operations were executed on thread from bounded elastic thread pool. Because now we subscribe not on the main method, but we subscribe to this flux on this thread pool. That's why all operations were executed on this thread pool. Okay, I hope it's clear. And let's look to the second one. It's publish on stream. We have the same flux. So the same filter, map, take, subscribe, but now we don't have subscribe on, we have publish on. And let me run this. And from example, we will see what this publish on do. Okay. So we see that, as I said, we subscribed on main because we don't have subscribe on operator. Then we executed filter on main, and we see that filter thread is main. But then after this publish on method, all our operations were executed on this bounded elastic thread. And that's why we could see that map was executed on bounded elastic thread. And actually take also was executed on this bounded elastic. So for summary, publish on allows to switch all below operations to the new thread pool. And we could combine this publish on, subscribe on, and work with our threads with easy. Okay, sounds good. Let me return this back and let's see what we can do. So here I changed my controller to flux, but the main changes are in this service. We still have our clients, they didn't change, but for now I'm creating flux from our clients and flat map to this get flights method. And get flights, now I'm calling subscribing on this bounded elastic. So I'm not subscribing on native threads. I'm subscribing on this bounded elastic threads, which allows us to still receive the requests. So let's run this and see. Okay, net is started, everything is good. Let me switch here, close this one. Okay, we still see reactor method. Let's give some load. Okay, what do we see? Now we see that this IO work from our clients was moved to this bounded elastic. And this bounded elastic, it's a limited thread pool. So it's not so big, but it do all this work so well. And if I try to call my fast endpoint, it returns back immediately because we don't busy our netty thread pool. Now we busy our custom thread pool. And this is much better because for now we have isolation. So if we have much IO operations on our thread pool, we still could receive requests and give the response back to the clients. Okay, this is much better. But we still have these IO calls and we don't want to have them. Unfortunately, with the new Reactive stack, Spring team introduced two big features. The first one is web client, and it comes instead of REST template. And web client works on netty, of course, because netty is good, and it sends the requests in non-blocking manner. So when with REST template we have a blocking call, with web client we have non-blocking call. So we don't block our threads. And the same is for repositories. Especially for Mongo repository, now we have reactive Mongo repository, which also allows to return not the list from our repository, but return mono or flux. Okay, sounds good. Let's see how it looks in code. Let me stop this and switch to the true reactive branch. Okay. What could we see here? Now, instead of Spring Boot Starter Data MongoDB, we have MongoDB Reactive. So here, instead of Mongo repository, we have Reactive Mongo repository and return flux instead of list. This is the first important point. And the second one is here, that instead of REST template, we have web client, and web client looks very easy. So we are sending GET requests to this URL, and I will show you the main configuration. It's also very simple. So I have a bin of web client, and base URL is localhost 8081. And we have the response as flux. So we are calling body to flux and receive flux instead of list. So as you can see, let me go to the service. So now we don't have any blocking calls, and we always return only flux. And also I have added here not the application JSON media type, but now it's text event stream, and this will allow us to stream values. Okay, so let me show you. Okay, first of all, let me call send one request. Lights. As you can see, we received results from database separately because I allowed streaming. So when data was available from database, we received it. And only then we received the response from our slow service. And if you remember, on the beginning of presentation, I said that the response time of our system is equal to response time of the slowest data source. For now, it's not true. For now, we are doing the streaming and we receive data as it comes, as it's available. And let's look to our threads. So for now, we have these reactor threads. And let's give the load to this. Okay, we see that we have limited number of threads, so it's not so big, and all our threads are green. So we don't have any blocks, we don't have any weights. Our threads are working, and we are utilizing our resources efficiently. And if we look to the results, here we see that all our requests were successful, and the minimum response time was 3 seconds, and maximum response time was 3 seconds and 400 milliseconds. So almost the same. We don't have like for sync when we had 3 seconds and 1 minute for maximum response time. Okay, so we have built true reactive application and resolved our problems. And let's have a summary on this. First of all, Reactor is not about multi-threading. Reactor is about efficient use of your resources. So it allows you to use your resources efficiently for almost 100%. It makes system more resilient, and of course it allows to operate with data flow with declarative approach, because as you have seen, we had these fluxes, so we had this stream of data, and it looks good as for me. But for sure, we have disadvantages. With reactive approach, it's hard debugging and testing, because for now we're switching our threads and we couldn't just go one by one in our breakpoints. And for sure, we need the new testing tools for testing these reactive data streams. But fortunately, we have these testing tools, but they are different from the default ones. For sure, we don't have thread locals because we don't have a thread which associated with our requests. And unfortunately, this means that we couldn't use, for example, Spring Security, which is built on top of thread locals. We have a reactive Spring Security with Spring 5, but it's also different from the usual Spring Security. So you need to investigate how it works, and it takes time and resources, of course. And this is more complex than imperative approach. So I used to write just code line by line and don't think about threads. But in this reactor, you need to think about it, and you need more experience, you need more knowledge to know how to use it. And finally, I want to say that Reactor is not a spring, is not a silver bullet. So you couldn't use it everywhere. For example, if you don't have so much load and Spring MVC servlets are working fine, you are good. You shouldn't just go and rewrite everything to Reactor, because it wouldn't bring much efficiency for you. But if you have some kind of problems, which I showed today, so maybe you could think about it and just try to rewrite some components to the reactive approach and looks and look, maybe you will love it as me. Okay, thank you for your attention. That's it. Maybe you have any questions, feel free to ask. I would be happy to answer. Basically, this is my email, so maybe if you will have any questions in future and you want to get an answer, so feel free to email me. I will be happy to help you. Thank you, Jose. Thank you. If there is no questions, so maybe I could give a word to Andre.
Yep. So thanks, Damir. Thanks, Maxim. On behalf of Provectus, I would like to thank everyone for joining this tech talk. Like Damir mentioned, if you have any questions, here is the contact information. You can write us and ask both technical questions, or if you have any questions about the company, Provectus, feel free to contact us. Also, just a reminder to go online to our provectus.com website and check for open positions if you would like to apply for the different careers that we have open at the moment here in Costa Rica and also in other countries. I think that's it. So thank you very much. And yeah, feel free to reach out to us. Thanks, everyone. Have a good night.